Are you, can we see each other?
Yep, I see you good and everything.
Good.
How you doing?
Thanks for doing this. Thanks for being engaged. It matters a lot. I need the help. I need to listen a little bit too. So, fire, then tell me you have some questions for me.
Yeah, I got some questions for you. You know, I'm going to just dive right in. You know, the president has talked about the systematic racism, but whenever he's asked, really, I mean, he just says that the answer is a better economy, that, you know, that's what'll fix it. But I really don't think that that's the answer. So I want to ask you, Mr. Biden, you know, Black Americans, we need a specific plan of action on how you plan to eradicate white supremacy in our country. And I know it's broad, but I just would love to know a few of the ways you want to go about doing it.
First of all, I don't even think Trump's even acknowledged white supremacy. Did the president acknowledge white supremacy?
Yeah, I just seen an interview the other day where someone's bringing it up, and he's just, you know, he acts as if it's not a real thing. You know,
so it is a real thing. Okay, I'm sorry. I thought you were making real news, or I thought you said that Trump said there's white supremacy and we have to do something about it.
No. He doesn't care about it. He doesn't validate it.
He doesn't even acknowledge it. He doesn't think it. You know, I'm thinking, and he thinks the way things are going are just fine. Look, this guy's run his entire career on dividing people, blaming people. You got a problem, it's the other guy's my problem. I don't do it. He never takes responsibility. Look, I promise you this. I'm not going to traffic in fear and division, and I'm not going to fan the flames of hate. I'm going to seek to heal the racial wounds that have long plagued this country and not use them for political gain. As president, look, my commitment to you is to lead on those issues and to listen, because I truly believe in my heart of hearts, we can overcome so much of what's happening. When we stand together, finally, as one America, we're going to rise stronger. But here, we also can't wait until I get to be president. We got to urge the Congress to take immediate action right now. No more excuses. No more delays. Outlaw chokeholds. Stop transfers of weapons of war to police departments. Improve oversight and accountability. Create a model use for force standard for every single police department in America. Create a National Police Oversight Commission. And we need each and every police department in the country to undertake comprehensive review of their hiring, their training, and their de-escalation practices. We got to prioritize the role of using what we call, and you're very informed on this, but pattern and practice investigations, which we started in our administration, to investigate, to strengthen our justice system and move. And so, you know, we got to give Justice Department more authority for the Civil Rights Division. There's so much. You know, look, systematic change also includes economic justice. You say it doesn't, but it does. What's happened is, until there's genuine economic justice, equal access to wealth, things aren't going to fundamentally change. Even if we change the cops. Look, here's what's happened. Your generation has been clobbered since 9/11. The Great Recession, when we, in fact, when Barack and I got elected. Guess what? Black Americans lost about 45% of their wealth and their homes and everything. They never got back. It still hasn't gotten back. And what we're doing is, in every crisis, as we rebuild the crisis and climb out of it, minorities get further behind, not ahead. And Congress has to fix the racial disparity. Disparities in the COVID recovery funds. Look,
yes.
You may remember, I'm the guy that pointed out and insisted that the CDC, not because I'm so special, I don't mean it that way, that they keep precise statistical data on who is getting COVID-19 and who's dying from it. And guess what? Those numbers we talk about, you know, you're six times more likely if you're Black if you get contracted. Look, I mean, We need to pay essential workers, not just praise them. Who are the essential workers carrying us in the back? Minorities.
Yeah.
Black.
I want to back up to what you had just said prior to talking about, you know, just making sure that the people in positions of power are going through the proper trainings, you know, to make sure that there aren't any biases. There is no racism in that. You know, we know that the people that are out there protecting us are going to be protecting us, you know, because we deserve to be protected. But I want to cover another aspect of it, which is in the education system. You know,
what
would be the specific things that you would want to help to show the full perspective and not just one narrative of what slavery did to this country and the history of Black
people? First of all, talk about it. Talk about it. Teach it in school. It's the original sin of America, the original sin. We talk about what happened in World War II with Japanese prison camps in the United States. And we have talked about how awful it is for Japanese Americans. Yeah. This and the treatment of Native Americans are the original sins in this country.
Absolutely.
They should be taught, number one. Number two, one of the things I believe very, very, very strongly is any child, no matter what their background, no matter what their economic background, no matter what their zip code is, about 60% of their brain is developed by their age 3 or 4. They should be in school, not daycare, school. So that's why I propose to triple the amount. We'll get this done. Triple the amount of money available for Title I schools, schools that are in distressed areas, in terms of economic distress, not just based on color. Poor folks, period. Right now, they get $15 billion a year because it was acknowledged years ago that there was a discrepancy. Because on a tax base, we'll make that $45 billion. Pay teachers $60,000 a year to teach in there. The lowest paid people, you can graduate magna cum laude from a great school, and you're going to get 23% less starting off if you're an education major. Only one that gets less is my daughter, who has her master's in social work. And, you know, involved in the community. I mean, they're the only people that get paid less. But put that up, you know, here we are in a situation where we're going to have to make sure that we deal with this in a way that we, for example, you realize we only have one school psychologist for every school psychologist now for every 1,505 kids.
I think that 1,000% in terms of mental health across the board, you know, we need more of this, of more therapists in schools, talking to the kids, talking through the issues on race, talking to the issue of systematic racism, talking on the issues of just how we learn to band together and think for ourselves. We risk taking.
Exactly right. Because look, here's what you have it exactly right. That's why I push so hard to increase by billions of dollars the number of healthcare facilities are available for mental health. For mental health in communities. And by the way, all the studies have been done in the last 5 or 6 years. Mental health problems aren't caused by drug abuse. Mental health problems promote drug abuse.
Yeah.
So when you see the most stressed generation in America is the Z generation. Kids have made 7 on. So these kids, if you have a school psychologist around, you're not going to institutionalize the kid, but you're going to be in a position where that child is able to pick up the anxiety quickly and be able to treat that anxiety. The other thing is that we have to make sure that all those kids are in school, full-time school. It shows that if they're in school age 3, 4, and 5, they have the opportunity increased by 58% their ability to get all the way through 12 years of school without any difficulty. That's why I'm proposing $70 billion. I've been pushing this for a year for HBCUs because they don't have the laboratories. They don't have the capacity to compete for all those contracts that are out there that are billions of dollars of contracts that are there that train students in everything from geopositioning, whole range of new technologies. They don't have the endowments.
Well, I also want to ask, get into, you know, you're talking about Corona, COVID-19 and what it's done to, the community, and also, you know, yesterday the May job report was released, and it has some good news, recording a drop in unemployment, but not for all people. I mean, you see the Black and the Asian Americans saw a slight increase, and so given
by the way, for Black youth, it went up almost to 38%. Okay, it's up, way up.
Right. So I ask you, given the massive unemployment that's come out of coronavirus, which I think was not handled well by the administration, how are we supposed to get the support that we need when people are asking these people to pay their bills and to do this and do that, but they don't have any income, you know, except the bills keep piling up, you know, there's more and more debt. I mean, how do we reverse that? How do we stall that? What's that about?
Change who's running the show. Here's what I mean. The Congress passed $2 trillion in the CARES Act. Supposedly there was supposed to be about 3/4 that was supposed to go to poor people and to Black businesses, to minority businesses across the board. None of it's gotten there. For only 40% of that money, the rest has gone to major corporations. It's not supposed to. The president's fired every single inspector general who's supposed to oversee this.
Mr. Biden, how can this, I think, and this is every young person's question, is how can this happen? You know, we sit, we grow, we watch, and it seems like every single day we learn more about the lies and the corruption that people get to do. And how do we feel engaged to know that, you know, if we, when we do vote and when we do stand up for something, that it's actually going to come to, that the money actually is going to go to the right place when we see that it hasn't in so many ways. And so many
times. Let me give you an example where it went to the right place. When Brock and I got elected, we inherited the most significant financial recession in American history. President put me in charge of putting out $840 billion of help. Guess what? It got put out with less than 0.2% waste or fraud. The inspector general was with me, and it saved tens of thousands of jobs. It made sure all those first responders were able to have a job. The teachers didn't get fired. When the budgets of the states got cut, you know, they have to balance by budgets. We moved in and we made sure the school system stayed alive. We made sure they got funded and so on. What we have to do is we have to make sure that here's what I think has happened. I think an awful lot of ordinary people have never thought of it in terms of there being institutional racism. They don't think of it. It is. There is overwhelming institutional racism. But they don't think of it. And all of a sudden, they woke up and realized during this pandemic for the last 4 months, who's been carrying them on their back? Who's been carrying them on their back? Hourly workers, the people who are standing out there and making sure that they decontaminate an operating room after it's all over, making sure they have enough nurses, making sure there's truck drivers to deliver goods, making sure we're in a position where you have a grocery clerk who is actually stacking the shelves so you have something to eat. And all of a sudden, they're beginning to realize, whoa, we have a chance now. And by the way, the other thing we have a chance to do is, you've seen, there's an awful lot of cops out there who are good people, and they're now taking knees. They're beginning to march. Last night here in the city of Wilmington, Delaware, where I am, the chief of police marched arm in arm with 1,000 protesters talking about. So we have to bring people together, and I think people are ready to come together. But we have to make sure, as I told the Floyd family, we have to make sure justice is done.
Absolutely.
People are held accountable.
People do want to be united. You know, I want to believe that things are...
I'm sorry, everyone. Oh, I'm so sorry to interrupt, Keke. Mr. Vice President, I think we'll have to do this. This might need to be the last question, and then we'll have to...
Keke, maybe we
could... Y'all could go all day. This is good.
It'll be quick. My last one is just going to be, what do you say to the young people that feel like it is no... reform that's going to change things? What do you say to young people that feel like the only way to shift America is to cut it by the poisonous roots that it was built on and create a whole new system? What's your response to that?
My response to that is, I don't know any system. I think that's what's happening now. We're losing our democracy. We're not actually exercising our democracy. It's a little thing that the same thing that was said when my generation, when I was a kid, watching Bull Connor sick those dogs on those ladies going to church and ripping skin off of little kids with fire hoses and the rest. Everybody said, that's done. He's put a stake in the heart of the civil rights movement. But guess what? When everybody saw it, they looked at it and said, oh, my God, I didn't believe it. I didn't believe it. And all those folks who lived in areas where there weren't any black folks said, whoa, this is really happening? Whoa. There's an awful lot of folks who got woke up real quick watching that cop push his knee for 8 minutes and 42 seconds. It was. But by the way, guess what, though? People are angry. There's movement. We take advantage of the movement. Take advantage of the moment and make the system work. Have justice. Make sure that a president doesn't have... This president invoking the military to eliminate... I mean, look what's happened. You've had 4-star generals, they're not Democrats, all come out and say, whoa, this is outrageous. Did you ever think, if you and I had this conversation 3 weeks ago, did you ever think that that two Marine generals, commander-in-chief, 4 stars, white guys, would be coming out and saying what they said?
No, but it's important that they do, because those men in those uniforms, they represent something major in this country. And when they perspective feels, just like when the police officers do it, political people do it, and just everybody in everyday world, when we decide to challenge authority in our field, we set the stage for change. And so I'm very
By the happy. Way, I agree with you. You set the stage for change. That was a peaceful in Lafayette Park, we were being peaceful. And these guys did what this president ordered, something no president has ever done.
It's not good. It creates division. It incites the worst, you know, and so, yeah.
It does, but also I think it's going to create unity. We have to take advantage of the horrible thing. Create unity. Together, there's nothing we cannot do. Nothing we cannot do.
Well, I know you got to go, and I'm so sorry. I know you got to go, but I just... Before they came back in, I want to say thank you for having the talk. Me as a young person, I'm really just trying to be more engaged and understand and hear everybody's perspective.
Maybe I can call you on the phone next couple of days. We could have a conversation.
Let's do it. I would appreciate it. I really, really would.
I'll do it.
All right. Thank you.